Fistula is a lifestyle-associated problem which causes not only physical pain but mental stress as well. Due to lack of awareness, wrongly treated fistula further aggravates so many problems. Recurrence of a boil, abscess or a knot near the anus from which parts of blood seeps out despite all efforts to treat it could be an instance of fistula. A long-time presence of infection in wound or muscle inside the anus causes fistula. Though from the outside in the form of a wound or an abscess, it may seem small, but on the inside its roots are deep. It may look like that it has been cured from the outside, but after a few days, the fistula may reappear in another place. At that point of time, it is assumed to be incurable, but that is not the case. Treatment of fistula is completely possible.
Fistulas and its types.
Fistula is primarily it's a tract which forms by a leakage from the inside the inner canal, and it is like a tunnel from which the fluid or gas is coming out, and it is opening outside the inner canal through the skin. Sometimes it is pus discharge, sometimes it is blood discharge, sometimes it can be gastric discharge, or very rarely it can be stool discharge also around the inner canal, which is known as fistula.
What are types of fistulas?
There are different type of fistulas. Primarily, I am talking about fistula in ano, where the leakage is from the anal canal and it is coming out around the skin of the anus, and from where this fistula is pus and blood discharge is coming. This is the commonest. This type of fistulas then that are further classified into different categories: high fistulas, low fistulas.
Yes.
Okay. Then there are different isolated special classifications, special fistulas, which are like anoscrotal fistula, where the fistula is starting from the anus canal and going into the scrotum. Then there can be anoscrotopenile fistulas. Then the fistula has started from the anus, gone into the scrotum, as well as gone into the penis. So these are different type of fistulas. Then same thing can happen in females also, where we call them as anovaginal fistula. We have to understand anovaginal fistula and rectovaginal fistulas are two different things. When the fistula's tract is starting from the anal canal and going into the vagina, it is known as anovaginal fistulas.
Okay.
Then some fistulas like are horseshoe type of fistulas. This is another classification, where the fistulas are taking the long curved tracks, which is the shape of the horseshoe, like they are taking almost a W pattern. This type of fistulas, the fistula is starting from the right hip and traveling towards the left hip and forming a W, this type of, or a, like a horseshoe pattern. This type of fistulas are known as horseshoe fistulas. Then again, according to the shape also, then we can label them as inverted Y fistulas, where there are two internal openings and one external opening. Sometimes there are Y-shaped fistulas, one internal opening and two external openings above. Then it can be M-shaped fistulas. It can be different shapes. But primarily, if we go on the this type of fistulas, we think that we classify them at high or low. High fistulas are difficult to treat. Low fistulas are also not easy fistulas, but they are relatively easy to treat in comparison to high fistulas. If you think that fistula is a easy disease, it is not that. If you are taken it lightly, it is going to recur 100%, because it starts with the injury. Injury is in the form of inner fissure. Inside the anal canal, when somebody is passing stool, there is a cutting, since cutting which causes on and off painful defecation. It causes sometimes burst blood discharge, and patient feels a lot of discomfort while passing stool. So this is the situation of inner fissure. When this cut is keep on getting deep, and then there is a complete puncture. So puncture will mostly happen at one place. It will not be complete line which will be showing that fissure. It will not be along the complete line of the fissure. It will be at some point in between where the high pressure is there and that has given, or where the tear has deepened too much. So these type of fistulas are like, even if it is a low fistula, it can recur from the side of the tear. It can happen at just next to where the initial tear had started. If you have repaired, it doesn't mean that it will be 100% cure. There are chances. So aim of treatment is always completely treat that fissure area and repair that internal puncture area. And we have to understand the mechanism. And the mechanism, because when it is because of the high pressure or straining, then we have to work on that also, that there should not be any straining, there should not be any obstruction in the path of stool, so the patient do not have to strain. So then only this type of fistulas can be cured, whether it is a high or it is a low. So many people think, oh, I had a low fistula in my MRI, I did the treatment, but it has recurred. It has recurred because there were multiple places it was injury, but one place has been repaired. That is one cause. There can be many other causes for the recurrence also. Recurrence can be because of we are not able to reach that area where the internal opening is there. Sometimes they say it is a sinus. I got operated for a perianal sinus. There was no internal opening. My MRI was not showing any opening. But it is almost not possible. It is not possible that there is no leakage inside and the pus starts forming outside. Then it is a boil. Then it is not a fistula. All perianal sinuses are fistulas. Yeah, I can say that probably we are not able to identify that opening. Right now it is so weak, so small, that is not identified. If in that case you are thinking of treating that sinus by surgery, it is better not to do surgery if you are not thinking of curing or clearing that internal opening. So if you are suspecting, if you have high suspicion internal opening is this point, then you should proceed and find it out and clear it out. If you are thinking, no, it is a sinus, I will just take out the track, it will be okay. No. It is one rare circumstance it can happen, that if that sinus is a pilo needle sinus. Some of the patient I have treated where there was a pilo needle sinus, there was a clear cut hair inside those tracks, and when we did the MRI, the MRI people were telling us, the doctors were telling us, the radiologist was telling that there is a Satan inside. But I was still doubtful. I took the patient for the surgery. I thought either I have to find out the internal opening or whatever the cause. And when we removed that sinus, we could find out the tuft of hair in it. And that tuft of hair in that fistula, that sinus, was looking like a Satan placed inside. So the doctor was confused that there was no surgery done. I was also sure that there was no surgery done. Patient was telling that there is no surgery done previously, but MRI is showing a Satan. So in that cases, there can be a pilo needle sinus, which is actually a sinus which is not communicating with the rectum. Otherwise, there is nothing like perineal sinus, which is a blind ending. They have to be fistula. We have to identify and clear it. That's it.
Okay, so we will identify it with the help of MRI.
Yeah, MRI is able to identify, but it cannot identify in all. Any patient, normally people do sinogram. Sinogram, even a proper fistula can be missed out, which has internal opening. That can be recognized with the help of MRI. But when this type of cases where internal opening is so bleak and it has so scarred that it can be missed on MRI.
Okay, so basically what are the common symptoms of this fistula?
Common symptom of fistula is painful swelling around the anal canal, a swelling which keeps on coming and going. Especially this type of swelling increases after constipation. Once the constipation is there, they feel swelling in that area, and sometimes they feel pus discharge, sometimes they feel blood discharge, sometimes just a gas bubble forming, and when the patient sits on that, he feels a little comfortable because that bubble, where the pus has collected, it drains internally, so it gives some comfort to the patient. and patient feels some pus leakage was there or some gas leakage was there. After that, he became comfortable. These type of symptoms are there of the fistula.
And what are the causes of these fistulas?
Commonest cause for fistula is constipation. Whenever it hurts too, it starts injuring the inner canal. It leads to the you can say fissure formation, and that fissure formation, patient starts taking different type of medication. He starts applying different anesthetic creams, and because of that anesthesia in that region, the injury is also happening. Injury is happening, but patient is comfortable because if I give a local anesthesia or any anesthesia, I just make this area numb, and still that area, when the numbness has been created with the medication, stool is still injuring them, and gradually that injury will lead to complete tear in the inner canal, from where that puncture forms, and from that the leakage starts, and then the fistula forms. Most of the patient have this cause. It can be different age groups has different causes. Young children may be because of constipation. Maybe that leakage is congenital. At the time of the birth, they already had that leakage, and gradually it starts forming. But in adults, it is constipation, a fissure leading to that fistula. And pregnant females, again, the constipation is the cause, which leads to different type of problems. And in adults, again, the constipation. All the people who are on medication, like some people are on diuretics, some hypertensive medicine, or some patients are taking medication for their kidney problems, some diuretics, which is leading to the whole of the water going out through the stool and through the urine, and whatever the water is in the body wants to retain it, and it starts absorbing from the stool. The stool formation becomes hard, and that starts cutting inside the inner canal. And that is the another cause of this fistula. Patient says, I started that medication, I started some antibiotic, after that it has come up. But actually that time, after the medication, he developed some sort of constipation. And for that constipation, he did not took proper care or medication, and that kept on injuring that area, and that led to formation of the fistula.
Basically, these fissures, inner fissure, are main causes of?
Yeah, it is a commonest cause for this problem.
Okay, so what is the rule of conventional surgeries in fistula?
So before doing any conventional surgery or any treatment, first of all, we must diagnose it completely. Because what happens is, whenever you are starting the treatment, there are different modalities available. There will be surgical treatment also, there will be medical treatments also. The ones who do not understand the complete mechanism of fistula, they will start giving you, or just for their own benefit, they will start giving you different type of things which will be laxatives or some sort of antibiotics. Laxatives will reduce the pressure in the inner canal, and patient feels some discomfort, that some comfort. And second thing, when he is taking that light diet, pressure inside the canal reduces, they start feeling a little bit of comfort. Along with when they give the antibiotic, that external opening starts getting healed. But healing of external opening is not the treatment. Be it with any medication, be it with your natural herbal medicine, be it with the home remedies, your homeopathic medicine, Ayurvedic medicine, or allopathic medicine, all of them are going to only treat external thing. They are not able to work. Even surgery is also a difficult thing to cure that internal leakage. So medication is not going to work at all. So whatever medication, whatever numbness you are creating with the help of different antibiotics or different local anesthetic creams, they are ultimately going to increase the problem. If there is one external opening, you start taking medicine, whatever medicine I tell you, I will not label it as homeopathy, I will not label it as allopathy or homeopathy or whatever. Whatever you are taking, it is just going to heal that external wound. If you still want to take medication, there is no harm. You do an MRI, start the homeopathic treatment, Ayurvedic treatment, or whatever way you want to start. Take that treatment after 3 months, 6 months, whatever time your doctor says, do the MRI. Is there any improvement? And what aim should be, you should be medicine free for at least 1 month when you are doing the MRI. If you are on antibiotic, if you are on medication and you are doing an MRI, there is high chances that infection, that tunnel which was filled with the fluid with the help of medication, that will just dry up. But drying up the tunnel is not the solution. We have to cure the internal leakage.
How we can diagnose this, you know, fistula and nano?
Fistula and nano can be diagnosed primarily, first diagnosis is clinical. Most of fistulas can be identified clinically. But localizing the internal opening is always a challenge. It is not that easy to find clinically. Many times opening is so small, even with the help of or normal instruments, we are not able to see that. So then MRI is a very good modality which is available, which can help us finding the fistula, identifying the fistula tracks, it's identifying its roots, and where exactly from where it is starting, the internal opening we can identify with the help of this. MRI is not just helpful for identifying the fistula, it is also helping us for the completion of the treatment. Once we have started the treatment, we have completed the treatment, after that also we do MRI to check that the thing is completely cured or not. But the identification of MRI, or you could say the interpretation of MRI, is not that easy even for the best of the radiologist. I am telling you some of the cases where our radiologists are not able to find. There can be 2-3 reasons. One, once patient has taken a lot of antibiotics, that fistula is in a suppressed state, then these people will not be able to identify. It's difficult for them. I'm not saying not able to, that makes it difficult for them to identify. Another is, it's very difficult. Recently I had a patient where the patient was having a recurrent gas formation in the scrotum. He had typical symptoms of constipation. He had already undergone a fistulectomy also, but MRI was not able to identify anything. Patient has typical symptoms of, he was feeling that after passing stool, he is feeling a gas in the scrotum or the testicular area. When he presses, he feels comfortable and the gas leakes out through the anal canal and he is becoming comfortable. So we did the MRI, but we were not able to. I sent him to the different radiologists, tried to identify what is the issue, why I was not able to find. But when we discussed in the detail, we realized that fistula, whenever it is having fluid, the fluid intensity is there, that can be identified with the help of MRI. Mm-hmm. But when there is air in that, it is difficult. And if you are not too much expert, or if you are not looking for it, you can miss it. Some patients, MRI can be combined with CT scan to identify this type of air signals. But high level of suspicion has to be kept, then only you can identify, otherwise you are going to miss it. So now, discussing about the treatment part, whether it is a low fistula, whether it is a high fistula, we have to treat them like all as a complex fistulas. There is nothing like a simple fistula. Some patients will get cured very fast, some patients will take long time. Some patients it is supra-levator, some patients it is above the edentate line. These are little more complicated as compared to the ones which are below the edentate line. And for this type of fistulas, we require a longer treatment than the usual. And these fistulas recurrence rate is high, because when you go in that area, you try to treat that area, but you miss it out. Though you are identifying that opening, but that opening is too high, you are too much scared to work in that area because you are worried about the sphincter controls. So, but actually, sphincter control is one thing which is making everyone so much scared about this fistula surgery. Though it's a very important aspect, but we cannot let the fistula damage whole of the anal canal but just because of our fear that this can reduce the control. If minor reduced control is there after the surgery, we should not be worried about, but our aim should be completely cure the fistula if it is possible. And most of the fistulas are curable. This is a myth that this fistula cannot be cured. Fistula was initially known as, in the one word which was known as Nasur. Nasur means keep this a type of tumor or something, an ulcer which will never go clear. But it is not true with the fistula. Almost all type of fistulas are curable. Some may require less time to treat, some may require longer time to treat. Another common myth is that fistula can come back, recurrence is there. Recurrence can happen with any disease. If you have done a bypass, maybe after 5 years you will have to do re-bypass. If it's a lifestyle related. If you take good care, there is less chances. And if the fistula is not treated, if you have not completely treated, it is 100% going to get recurrence. Patient says, I have taken 5 years of medication. Till I was taking medication, I was okay. And I stopped medicine, I had improved. That doesn't mean you are not treating the fistula, you are just suppressing the fistula with the help of medication. So that is not actually treatment. Actual treatment of fistula involves closure of the internal leakage point. If you have closed that internal leakage point, this fistula will get cured. If you have not done, you are just suppressing with whatever sort of treatment you are doing.
Okay. So what is role of conventional surgeries in fistulas?
Conventional surgeries are in the form of fistulectomy, fistulotomy, and then laser surgeries, then there are anal fistula plugs, and some Shastra treatment. These type of are different type of modalities which are available. And then another modality is like where they were putting the glue also. This is another modality. But these are all modalities, some of them are successful, some of them are almost negligible success. So we have to choose what is best in the best situation. In fistulectomy, we normally remove the fistula tract and let it heal. But recurrence rate is almost 30-35%. The reason is, it is not the problem with the surgery. Surgeon has done his job best. He has removed the complete fistula, but your body has not formed the tissue right way. Skin has a tendency to heal first as compared to the fat, because fat has low vascularity and whatever the lower tissue. If that gap is inside, patient is going to get recurrence. So if that healing has started from deep inside, there will not be recurrence. If it has healed from above and the inside thing is there, this is going to recur. You have to understand. And this is inherent risk with any treatment where we are not treating inside first and treating outside last. So aim of treatment is first treat the inside leakage. Once we are dealing that with that, definitely these patients are going to heal. If you are not dealt with it, you are going to get the recurrence. Maybe recurrence is 30%, maybe recurrence is 50%. Okay. So treat, and then fistulotomy also same thing, almost similar recurrence. And
these fistula plugs.
Then fistula plugs, then the laser is also destroying the tissue. But you are not removing, you are not closing the internal tissue, you are going to get the recurrence. Patient come to me, sir, I have done 5-10 surgery, 5-10 lasers, I have not got. Sir, I have done WAF treatment.
So, what basically we do in lasers?
Laser is primarily you are going to burn that tissue. There are n number of things available for burning that. You can be using radio frequency, you can be using different things. Only thing is laser is more precise, it is going to just which area you are working, that area it will burn. But burning is not the solution. We have to close that internal opening. If you have not closed it, whatever thing you have done, it is not going to help. So that's what I'm saying. That patient is coming, sir, I have done WAFT. WAFT means you're going inside, close that internal opening with a glue or something. But as the pressure increases, this can come up. Same thing is, but worst thing is, if you have not removed this, you just have done with some type of laser, just charge it, not close the internal opening, definitely he is going to get recurrence.
Okay, so with laser, chances of reoccurrence are also?
It is there, it is very much there. You can say 50% recurrence. So many people say, oh, laser has got so much recurrence. I was thinking that there is no recurrence. No, it is not. I have treated a number of recurrences from the lasers. So there is nothing like that.
Okay, so we have heard many times this technique, Shastra Sutra.
Shastra is a good technique which is going to help many patients. It has helped also. But what myth is that it is 100% correct technique, it is all patients will heal. No. That is a myth. Another problem with Shastra is it is unhygienic. Third problem is it's intolerable. Patient gets so much severe pain so much discomfort, they do not tolerate. They start the treatment, they run away. Then they get so much pain that then they will not go for any other treatment. They will start taking medication, they will miss out everything. So there's no point taking such treatment which you cannot continue. And again, the regress is also there. It is not that this is, you are not going to get regress. And same thing, just like lasers, n number of patients with the regress after Shastra we have treated. So with my experience, I can say this, all the modalities have regress. The modality which is treating first inside, be it fistulotomy, be it fistulectomy, be it Shastra, all are going to treat the patient. And be it Overcutaneous technique, be it waft, all these techniques, whichever is aiming to first control the inside, cure the inside and come out, they will treat the fistula. Otherwise, if you just say, I did this modality and I got regress, yes, you are going to get the regress unless we have treated the inside thing. Be it, you name any modality. You say, I use fistula plug. Fistula plug sometimes do more harm than the good, because fistula plug is a foreign body. Body has a tendency to evacuate that. You are putting something, already there was a small hole, you put such a big fistula plug in that the hole has not got just dilated. Your aim was to close that just like a puncture, but body, here it is a body, it is not a tire. Body will not let it be there. It will try to throw out the foreign body. Body is working against it, we cannot work on it. Body is guessing that the hole which was 4 mm now has become 1 cm. The symptoms have worsened. Okay. So whatever collagen you are using, it is a foreign collagen. It is, you are not making from the patient. If you are taking from the relative also, even then the body can reject it.
Okay, so is colostomy technique helpful in fistulas?
Actually, colostomy is not a technique for fistula treatment, but it has been misused for the, rather than misused, it is used for the cases to treat for temporary purpose. To divert the stool from the opening where is the leakage was forming, some channel is there, if the fluid is, a tunnel is there from where the things are coming and coming out here. And what we are doing is, to cure this leakage, I have made another way here. A bypass. We have started this, from the anus that stool is coming. Now instead of stool coming from that, you start coming, the stool start coming from here. If the stool start coming here, you work in the lower area, maybe you will heal. But that healing is not important. As once you close that area, it will again open up. So the colostomy has no role, at least in the cure of the fistula. It can control the fistula. It can control the sepsis. If there is a tumor or cancer in the inner canal, it will help in the diversion and keep the things in control.
We hear like many people are taking homeopathic Ayurvedic medicines for fistula. So what exactly these medicines are going to do?
Be it allopathic medicine, I'm telling you, be it homeopathic or any XYZ medication, they will temporarily reduce the pressure inside the inner canal. So pressure once decreases, the leakage will start slowing down. Then they give antibiotics, one or the other forms, different medication. They just dry that external hole. The skin starts feeling, patient starts feeling, oh, it has reduced, it has got control. But no, it is just the temporary control. As the pressure will increase, it will again open up. So all these medications are just suppressing the symptoms.
Suppressing and symptomatic treatment.
Yeah. But the problem with this is, unless and until there is a leakage opening, leakage is there. From one point, the leakage has started, another point it is coming out. Okay. Patient is okay. There is no problem. Because there is only discharge. But if that external opening closes, now what will happen? The fluid is coming. It is causing dilatation. It is making it bigger. And now the pain and swelling increases. And it will not open through the same hole, it will form another hole. And then the patient forms 2 holes, 2, 3 holes, 10 holes. All type of patient come to us with the, after taking this type of medication. So I do not recommend suppressing the fistula unless patient is like that. There is we cannot take for surgery, we cannot do anything for that fistula, then only we should think of any medication. Otherwise, medication is primarily to suppress the symptoms.
Okay, so what is the VARP technique?
VARP technique is a very helpful technique for the identification of fistula. Okay, again I will say, VARP is not a complete cure for the fistula. VARP will help us video-assisted fistula treatment, where we go with the help of a small endoscope, find out the internal opening. So many patients come, sir, my fistula, I had no fistula, I had a sinus. They operated me. After that, pus never stopped. But actually what has happened, they were not able to identify the internal opening.
Mm.
These type of internal opening, which are difficult to identify, maybe there are sometimes multiple openings. Okay. These openings can be identified with the help of VARP. Yeah, okay. They will help us identify the internal opening. And now our aim is whatever. If you want to do fistulectomy, your choice. If you want to do whatever modality, because you are working in the right place now.
Okay. So is there any chances of reoccurrence with the VARP?
Yes. If we do standalone VARP, there is chances of recurrence. Or if you are not able to close that internal opening, there is chances of recurrence. Okay. So there is no complete modalities. Different modalities have different success rate. We have to work on that and we have to identify what is going to be best for which patient. Complex fistulas, we have to use combination of techniques. Sometimes we combine VARP with the sitan, sometimes we combine VARP with the lift. That all is your individual experience. This cannot be labeled that this patient will definitely go into this. I have done VARP, I have regress, I have done Shasutra, I have regress, I have done this. This is not like nothing like that. Each patient, individual patient is different. And for that, we have to do a tailor-made treatment exactly according to his fistula opening, his biomechanics, his internal pressures and everything. And whatever damage has happened. Some patients will heal in one day, one sitting. Some patients will heal in 6 months. Some patients will take 2 years. Different patient, different damage, different time. No two patients are safe. If you start comparing yourself with another patient, you are doing something wrong to yourself. Whatever the treatment has to be taken, it has to be taken in the right direction. And the right direction of treatment is dealing with the internal. If you are not done with the internal opening, whatever you do DARP, VARP, DIFT, fistulotomy, whatever, you are going to get regress. And when you get a regress, then there are n number of people to trap you. They are ready. They are waiting now. Oh, I told you, don't do surgery, you will get regress. 70% of the patient got cured, but only 30 which do not cure, they made this type of statement that this thing will not work. It is not that. All patients will not fit into that, but different techniques are available. Our technique, which I'm going to talk again, is Qatar technique, where we are working first in the internal opening. We are using the VARP also combination. We are using the sitan also with this, and we are using the segmental resection with this. We are using the lift also in this. So all this combination is going to help the patient. And we can achieve near 100%. No, nothing is 100%, but we can achieve at least scientifically, biomechanics, we are almost everything. When we are correct, we expect complete resolution. Until we are not going into the biomechanics of the disease, we are going to get the regress.
Sir, what do you recommend for long-term, long fistulas or
recurrent
fistulas?
Okay. For the long fistulas or the recurrent fistulas, where you have done so many surgeries, patient is depressed, he thinks treatment is not possible, I did the surgery, I took the medication, I did everything, till I am taking medicine, I am comfortable. The first thing you have to forget, till you are taking medicine, you are just suppressing it. You have to understand, be it ginger, be it your XYZ n number of medicines, they are just suppressing it or they are just decreasing your constipation. Okay. So definitely they are helpful. I'm not saying they are not helpful, but you are taking time. You are decreasing the symptoms only. You are not curing it. But the problem with medication is you will close the external opening. If you close the external opening, it will form another opening. Initially you had one track, now you have two tracks to deal. So then it becomes a little more difficult for us to treat. Sometimes you get complete that anal canal gets damaged because of the chronic medication. You are anesthetizing that area with the help of medication. You are decreasing the pain, but that area is getting necrosed. This type of patient come to us. Sometimes they reach to the stage that this has gone and developed into the cancer also. And then they reach to us. Those situation treatment is absolutely difficult and almost impossible. Then we recommend them colostomy. Otherwise, all of them can, if they come in the right time, if they come at a stage where this tumor has not formed, they can be treated, or unless they have got the complete damage of the anal canal. There is a fear that when you do the treatment for this, you are going to lose your control on the, you know, this sphincter. Patient has a common myth. Oh, if you do the surgery, you will lose the control. Because this is not actually a myth, this is a created thing to discourage you. Though it is possible, but you have to think, if you are losing sphincter controls, or if you are losing whole of your anus, what you will choose? If you are going to get a cancer, or if you want to control the symptoms of infection, you are at least trying something to do it. Okay, I do understand surgery is painful, dressing is painful. For that, we have devised different mechanism, we have different techniques which are going to help. So that is why whatever the deficiencies were different in the list of different patients, we found out a technique with the help of which pain is negligible, bed rest is negligible. You can start working from the day 2 only. No, almost negligible eating restrictions, except I tell the patient, don't take too much spicy. If you want, you can take the spicy, but only thing, you will get burning in that area. Why you want to take? It is your choice. If you still want, you can keep taking the chilies also. Avoid the constipation. Yes, we have worked in an area. If you do, if you become part of constipated, you are injuring that area again. We are trying to repair it, and we are same time we are injuring. It is not a good idea. So these are the only restrictions. Even small children, when we do the treatment, they tolerate the treatment so well. 5 years, 6 years children, 1.5 year child, 15 year girls, 80 years old age man, all spectrum we have treated with the help of our special technique, where we are combining different techniques, and along with we are using the cutter technique, where we are doing the segmental resection of this type of complex fistulas. We are dealing with the stages where we know we cannot deal complete thing in one go. We gradually work in the most prominent area, most difficult area. And we work on the root of the fistula, where it has started, where the internal opening is, which is the leakage point. Okay. When we work on it, we repair it, we recreate that area. It may take a month's time, it may take a week time, it may take 6 months time, it may take 1 year. But all this area can be recreated, reformed, and then gradually, once we are done with this, all fistulas are going to heal. Unless this fistula, there are special circumstances, like I told you, if there is already cancer formed, we will not recommend treating it from the down. We will prefer to do whatever chemo or radiotherapy needs to be done and do the colostomy. It is a different situation, but otherwise most of these fistulas are curable. Some of them will heal very fast, some of them will take longer time. But best part about the treatment is, you come, get the treatment done, start sitting from the day one. No dressings, no painful dressing, like daily changing of the dressing. No external help needed, you can do it yourself. You are ambulant, you can resume your duties from day one or day two. And from my side, no restrictions on the food and everything. But if you are able to, while performing your normal duties, while performing your this thing, you are getting cured, nothing better is available, at least at present. This is the best thing which is available and which is helpful also. And one thing which is must to remember, that fistulas are curable if we are working the right way. Don't go with the name of the modalities, that I do laser, I do VAFT, I do XYZ. It is whatever is going to cure the internal opening is going to cure you. Okay, that's it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.